because it was stating things that many of us know, but the world didn't know about African people and who they are, what they've done in art, music, science, medicine, psychology, spirituality, and things like that. I am currently president of a small foundation called the Royal Circle Foundation, which Dr. Patricia Newton is also part of. I am completing a book that's going to be a bombshell. Hopefully it'll be out later this year or early next year, called We Were Never Slaves. And this really, as a journalist and friend, radio talk show host, Salim Muakil in Chicago, he said the greatest addiction we all are addicted to is our interpretation of reality. And we are addicted to the notion of African people as being inferior to people who classify themselves as white, as Dr. Francis Cress Welsing has stated many times. So that's a little bit about me.
Okay.
So what we're gonna do here, and we don't have a lot of time, you know, this really is a 3-hour presentation, but it's about understanding 5G. And we've heard a lot about 5G, so what I'm going to do is sort out disinformation, misinformation, conspiracy theories, propaganda, and facts, because we are involved in a war against reality. Philip K. Dick, a novelist and futurist, many of you have seen his movies or read his books, Minority Report, Man in the High Castle, it's a series on Amazon. But he said the basic tool for the manipulation of reality is manipulation of words. If you can control the meaning of words, you can control the people who must use their words. And to a large extent, most of us are being manipulated by words. Dr. Robin D. Kelly, professor of American history at UCLA, explains, language is both a weapon and a terrain of struggle. Words are not self-evident, they are eternal truths. They are not eternal truths, but reflect, reveal, conceal, and delimit, and produce meaning all at once, all at one time. So I think what we need to do is to give the audience some definitions between facts, propaganda, misinformation, and disinformation. There is distinctive difference between the two. We all have heard the whole idea, the whole notion of people say, show me the facts, right? But the question is, which facts and whose facts? The facts we know are true, the facts we think we know are true, are the facts we are taught are true, but really are nothing more than an opinion. So we have to understand these basic differences. Now, it may seem that, you know, I'm being superficial here, but I have to lay out the groundwork. So when we look at propaganda, for example, professor of philosophy at Yale, Jason Stanley, in his book, How Propaganda Works, he says it boils down to political rhetoric. But this political rhetoric aims to exploit the relationship between elites and the masses, right? And political rhetoric goes back to Kemet, or some people will know as ancient Egypt, and then later to Greece and Rome. And we see this laid out particularly in Plato's dialogue. So propaganda is any communication designed to manipulate a target population by affecting its beliefs, attitudes, preferences, in order to obtain behavior compliant with the political goals of the people who are propagating the propaganda. But, you know, contrary to Bernays with his PR piece and getting women to smoke back in, I think, around 1920 or something, propaganda can be negative or it can be positive, right? In a positive sense, we have the Catholic Society for the Propagation of the Faith, developed in 1822. Then we have Major Martin Delaney in 1852, before the outbreak of the Civil War, and he was a philosopher and major. The United States, according to him, is untrue to her trust and unfaithful to her process of principles of Republican equality, has a personal policy of political degradation to a large portion of her native-born countrymen, and that class is the colored people, i.e. black people, i.e. people of African descent. But Delaney was a believer in this institution and didn't at that time wanted to believe that he was a citizen, but technically that wasn't the case because Africans weren't brought here to be part of this political experiment. And so when we look at that, right, we can see that there is a difference between propaganda. We can think of propaganda as being played. We can look at the whole notion of misinformation, and many people get that confused as something that's fake and it's not true. But misinformation can be true, doesn't have to be fake. It depends on how the information is used.
And let me stop you for a minute. Let me stop you for a minute and ask you if you will define for us the difference between misinformation and disinformation.
Yeah, I'm coming to that.
Okay.
Now, many of the audience are familiar with Dr. Carter G. Woodson and the Miseducation of the Negro. And his book was speaking about misinformation, that we've been misinformed, that we've been told certain things and we've accepted them as facts, but they were someone else's facts. Disinformation is something different. It's explicitly false or misleading information. The falsehood may be in the origin of the information. The falsehood is involved in mass manipulation to appear other than what it is. And it can include misperceptions, misdirection, disorientation, distraction, all of these things to shift public attitudes and beliefs, particularly about different things. And we're going to use 5G as an example of that. And so disinformation is dangerous, and it can be part of an adversarial narrative. And that's is simply involved in conflict or opposition between various actors and their interests. and between a social in-group and a social out-group. So for us in the United States, in fact, most of the Western world, the in-group are people who classify themselves as white, as Dr. Welsing says, or, quote, white people, or some now say people of whiteness, right? And the out-group is everybody else. That means everybody else on the planet. It means Asians, Africans, and so forth. And so this adversarial narrative or disinformation can be amplified by individuals, groups, and institutions, right? And that's very important that we have to see that an adversarial narrative, disinformation, is embedded in the whole fabric of society, in religion, in entertainment, in sports. Every aspect of our society, we find this same adversarial narrative between the in-group and the out-group. But also, it can be involved in other things as well. You know, we hear people talk about branding, you know, the battle of the brands. Well, before branding became fashionable, branding was to state with a symbol or a phrase that this belongs to me, this is my property. And so people, human beings, well, let me say humans, the being is a whole nother thing. Maybe we can talk about that later.
On a different show. Yeah.
No, he said his battery went dead on his phone.
Okay, well, we'll have him get back on because he was in the middle of something very important, and so we need to continue with that. But I will pick up and do some things.
Hello. Hello.
Yes, go on, Dr.
Hello,
go
can
on,
you hear me?
Adam. Yes, we can. Go ahead, please. So we're losing time. Go ahead, please.
I don't know how much the audience
I don't either, but let me redirect the question for a second, because I'm sorry that we had it got cut off. Let us move into, as fast as we can, the example of 5G relative to disinformation, misinformation, and the immune system issues. Let's get there, because we're going to be losing some valuable time if we don't.
Okay, that's fine. So when we look at the whole question of 5G, well, first, what is 5G? And that simply refers to fifth generation of wireless phone technology. So there's been 1G, 2G, 3G, 4G, and now we have 5G. And soon we'll be getting to 6 and maybe 7G by 2030. This is going to be very quick. 1G was a certain bandwidth, and it was just analog communication. It was the first wireless communication technology from 1980 to 1990. 2G was the first digital technology, and this was from 1991 to 2000, and it allowed for text messaging. 3G allowed for smartphones and video calls, and it was faster communication. 4G, 2010 to today, allowed for mobile, multimedia, anytime, anywhere, integrated solutions, and customized personal service. And it had higher security than the previous ones. 5G is an extension of 4G, and that's from today to 2030. And it supports interactive multimedia and voice and video streaming. So what happened is many people believe, and there's a whole number of actors, political actors, state actors, grassroots actors, private influence actors, and the corporate world. And so it's really complex trying to sort all this out. But the point is, these people started back in 2016 with a campaign to discredit, to stop 5G, because it was something that they felt was harmful. And they cited specific studies, and I did research on this independently when I worked at a national laboratory in the late 1980s, that we live in an electromagnetic environment. And one of the things that I was doing then was looking at biological effects of magnetic field, electromagnetic fields. And there are effects. There's DNA effects. There's cellular changes. Some people can have headaches and things like that. There's a whole range of changes. But we've been living in this environment, this artificial environment, for now, you know, close to a century. And so life has adapted to this environment. And so the 5G conspiracy people, they want to say that 5G is the problem, but you can't separate out 5G technology from all the electromagnetic radiation that we are enveloped, embedded in every day of our lives. The fact is that life is adapting to this environment such that we are surviving. If it was as bad as they claim, and they have a whole host of claims, and I don't have time to, if I have time, I'll share some of them. But it goes back to when there was a conversation by the chairman of the Federal Communications Commission in June and July of 2016 regarding the rollout of 5G technology. After that, a group of people start, you know, people like Alex Jones and David Icke the UK. He's a professional conspiracy theorist. They started something called Empower Movement with YouTube and Facebook and Twitter and all the social media to scare people away from 5G technology. And so we always have to ask the question of who is benefiting from this? What's the purpose of it? It's serving a purpose for somebody or a number of people. Some people write books and make money. Others, it's a scare tactic to keep people disoriented and also overwhelmed by information. And so people end up believing things and not knowing the origin of how the conspiracy theory or the propaganda or the disinformation came about. And so, you know, they started this campaign on 5G changes everything. You know, and organizations in Europe and the UK warning 5G, and they cited a whole host of things that 5G causes, from from influencing changes in DNA to specific pregnancy problems, miscarriages, a whole host of things. And in fact, they say there's the death science depopulation trifecta between big business, the media, and pharmaceutical companies. And so they latched on to the whole anti-vaccine movement. And now, lately, they're saying that 5G is the cause of the coronavirus, which is absolutely, unequivocally false. Coronavirus has nothing at all to do with wireless cell phone technology. But so we've been exposed to all of this. So what do we do? We're overwhelmed. How do we sort out the disinformation from the misinformation? And there's an article on a blog post called One Thing You Can Do. It's written by Cindy Otis, and she's an author and also a former CIA analyst. And she talks about in this blog how you can avoid being overwhelmed and stay focused in the world, in the world, and not be consumed by the fake news. And that's one of the most important things. The takeaway message is we have to know ourselves. We have to watch out for confirmation bias, that is, anything that always agrees with what we already know. But we always have to look for, how did we come to know anything? What's the origin of that idea? Where did it come from? We have to know the outlet doing the reporting of that information. Today, we live in a time when various economic interests of ruling elites, or those who want to become ruling elites, create hundreds of fake websites. And it looks like it's news, of an official website of one of the major news organizations, but it's not. And so you have to look at the URL to be sure that it's not fake. And then we have bots or programs that are totally artificial, artificial Facebook and Twitter profiles. They're not real. You know, if you see someone on Facebook and they got a couple of friends, you know that's not real. Or if they just opened their account up a few months ago, that's suspect. And so we have to watch out for those type of things. we also have to look at the credibility of who is reporting the information. Can you trust Alex Jones, who has an agenda? If you ever see a picture of his InfoWars complex, it looks like a huge building that you would see out in the state, in a suburb. It's a humongous facility. So he's made a lot of money and continues to make money, even though he's been banned from YouTube. Or David Icke, the professional conspiracy theorist in the UK. It gets to be really tough when they mix factual information with misinformation and disinformation, and it becomes very difficult to sort all that out. And so you can't blindly trust any source. So what happens is you'll be led down the path of emotional non-information or non-stories or stories that misdirect your attention, like a magician. You know, they are expert in misdirecting attention. That's how you end up believing the illusion. You wonder, how did they do that? How did they pull a rabbit out of a hat when you didn't see a rabbit? Where did it come from? But while you're looking at the magician, he is misdirecting your attention with his gestures. And so the last thing is, don't be a part of the problem. Before you pass on information, whatever it may be, whether it's misinformation, which you may not know it is, or disinformation, don't be a part of the problem. Don't share something that's suspect. You know, these simple rules can help you, help us, not become a victim of misinformation. Because as Tom Burrell says in his book, Brainwash, we've been over five centuries subject to a narrative. And this was the masterful marketing of black inferiority. And it still plagues us today. I mean, we can disavow it, say it's not true, but when you listen to conversations of people, it comes out. So, and we end up believing that some people's ice is wetter and colder than other people's ice.
See if I can summarize it. So what you're saying is that every day, one, we're bombarded with these various and unsundry energies that may have some harmful effect, but our bodies have adjusted and I guess you would say mutated in some way to be able to absorb these, so that we're not as they're not as deleterious as they could be. And that the information that's coming out about 5G is no different than the exposure, I mean, that comes out about 5G is no different than what we've had in earlier first-time exposures, and that we've made the adjustment, and that people need to stop talking about 5G being a cause of lowering the immune system to the degree that you would get COVID-19. That's one takeaway. And the second takeaway I want to reiterate is that there are many ways that we as a people are being targeted for disinformation. And by that, I'm talking about African people, the world in general, but I'm specifically referring to people of African descent, that we are being targeted by various and sundry disinformational websites and bots that are creating confusion and for the purpose of control. Is that correct?
That's correct. We saw that. That was revealed in the whole Cambridge Analytica scandal. And the Trump campaign of 2016, the presidential campaign of 2016. And now they're ramping up and becoming even more sophisticated. And so, as I said earlier, that we're looking at a war against reality. The question is, what is our reality? What is African people's reality? And many would say that at the core is it's a spiritual reality which permeates everything that we have been about for the past, I would say, 200,000 to 300,000 years. And this is only like a nanosecond in the history of African people. And so we're adapting, but all of us are not adapting in a positive sense at the same rate. Because many of us, as Minister Malcolm told us, have been hoodwinked, bamboozled, and led astray. That's what disinformation does. It leads us astray from our true selves, the power that we have within ourselves, that we have tremendous amount of power, tremendous amount of creative energy, and the world, if you want to say, hacks our creativity in many different ways, and often to our detriment. And so we have to see that, you know, it's something, we have to keep an eye out everywhere, an eye out on everything. It may be challenging, it may be difficult, sometimes it may be confusing, but we really have to watch everything that we're being exposed to on an emotional level, a psychological level, spiritual level, as well as physical level. We have to watch the foods that we eat, because so many of the foods have chemicals in them that alter our bodies, alter our cellular structure, far worse than 5G. You know, young people are eating Flaming Hots with red dye number 2, a known carcinogen. And so there's things that we can do right now that can have a positive impact on our health beyond 5G. Vitamin D, you know, the whole coronavirus situation, there's all this talk about vaccines, but Dr. Pat, I'm sure you can talk about the likelihood there will ever be a vaccine for the coronavirus, which is, this version is very novel, and it's constantly mutating based on location and population. And so there's things that we can do which aren't being talked about. You know, there's precautions that we can take beyond just wearing a mask and social distancing. And that's a huge problem, particularly for people who are dying, when they end up in hospital beds or nursing homes and they're dying alone, and that goes against the way we've been socialized for the past 200,000 years of being there when a person is making their transition.
Right.
And so the consequences are horrific. And so we have to find ways to adapt to this new reality, this new situation that we're in. It's not going to be eternal. It's not going to last forever. But we can do things to protect ourselves, and certainly diet, the foods that we eat, is a crucial thing, and foods to avoid that are more harmful than 5G radiation, because we're consuming it. You know, the whole thing about the coronavirus, we saw all the meat packing plants that were closed. And then suddenly we are exposed to the horrific conditions that the workers in those plants were dealing with every day to provide the industry with chickens, pork, and beasts, even fish, artificial fish ponds. You know, fish aren't raised on corn. That's not part of their natural food source. But they're being fed those things. And so there's things that we can do. You know, we have to deal with the toxic environment that we live in. You know, one of the things when the economy shut down, suddenly the sky got clearer.
Yep.
Right? Smog dissipated over Los Angeles and in China. They could see the sky when, you know, I haven't been to China, but that's what I've seen pictures of what that looked like.
I've been there, and yes, it can be kind of muggy. Yep.
Right. And so, you know, we got an example of the type of toxic environment that we are in. But life is adapting. It's changing. You know, no one ever talks about 5G and its effects on plants that we consume. Right. Or the meat that we consume. If 5G is so dangerous and deadly, then the cows are being affected, the pigs are being affected, the chickens are being affected too, and we're eating them. But the conspiracy theorists, they never talk about that. So there's a conspiracy of omission that they omit certain things. And then there's commission. And so we have to really listen to what these people are saying and what they leave out and not get caught up in the rhetoric.
Let me ask you a question about that. When you talk about not getting caught up in the rhetoric, I'd like for you to delve into something that I heard called media literacy, and how that impacts upon us as a people.
Yeah, we have to learn critical thinking skills.
And that's not taught.
And that's
school.
And it's not taught in our schools.
Right.
We don't get critical thinking. We don't get media literacy. And that's really crucial, that we have to understand how we're being manipulated by media. And by media, I mean print, radio, television, social media, electronic media, advertising, fashion. All of those things represent media. Memes, all of those things represent media. And so we have to have a critical understanding of how we're being manipulated. That's one of the things that I look at from a cultural neuroscience perspective, is how do these ideas get embedded in our biology to the point that we believe them and not believe other things, that our minds become closed off to the truth of things. We can't see the truth in what we're seeing now because of the whole coronavirus, is that a lot of people are really showing themselves for who they really are. The hate is coming out because they're on edge. And so we have to have programs in our schools on critical thinking. It's really, really very important.
Let me just interject something here. I don't expect the public education system to ever teach our children how to do critical thinking, because then they would not be able to be so manipulated to, quote, have a job. What is it that you recommend that our communities, our people within our communities, African Americans, should do in order to help our children develop critical thinking? Because I don't think we can leave that to the public educational system.
Absolutely. If we go back to 1865, right, when General Sherman marched to Savannah, Georgia, And following him were 400,000 former captives. I don't use the word slave because folks were socially incarcerated. They were captives. And they marched all the way to the eastern coast from South Carolina to Florida. And so he convened a group. He didn't know what to do with all these people and these African people, former captives. And they were termed contraband. You know, that's a terrible word to be caused. And so he met with about 20 leaders, African leaders, former captives. Most of them were ministers, right? And asked them, what do you want? And they said, we want to be left alone. We want to, if you just give us some land, we will pay the United States government for the land in time. We want to be left alone, left by ourselves. And so what they did was they established institutions, they established schools and towns and businesses throughout the South, not just on the East Coast. And one of the most important things they did was have a freedom school. We need, that was rebirthed in the 1960s. We need to have freedom schools in our churches, freedom schools in our homes, where we are teaching these crucial skills of critical thinking and media literacy, and also how we can avoid being hoodwinked and bamboozled. And importantly, identify the people in our community who are bamboozling us. And that can be politicians, it can be educators, it can be athletes, it can be entertainers, it can be members of the clergy, because they have a vested interest in maintaining their status. And so part, Dr. Pat, of critical thinking, of media literacy, is to identify the people who are bamboozling us and not fall for the okey-doke.
Mm-hmm. That's critical.
Does that make sense?
It makes a great deal of sense, and I'd like to have you, before we end this hour, talk about how families and communities can begin to develop many MINI freedom schools within their homes, within their social networks, within their families themselves. I think that's an excellent idea, because we cannot keep waiting for somebody else to come and save us.
Well, the whole point that I brought that field order, special field order number 15 up, because we did it in 1865, and there's no reason why we can't do it again.
And we
there's nothing stopping us.
Yeah, we have less than
I'm sorry.
We do now. I said we had less then than we do now.
Right, and so there's no excuse now. There's no excuse, but music, as Fela Kuti said, is a weapon. It can be a weapon for liberation, or it can be a weapon for pacification. And so we're seeing that much of the music today is a weapon of pacification. And so we have to have a different type of music that's being played on the airwaves. And so people can, and I know it's going to be hard for young people, particularly teenagers, to monitor the music that they're listening to. But the problem is that the music affects how they think and how they behave. The music is directing a lot of the self-inflicted violence that we see, because it's normalizing it. And so that's one of the core components, I think, of any freedom school education, is understanding how one's behavior and beliefs are being affected by not only what you read, but what you listen to, what you dance to. You know, people will say, well, I'm dancing to the music because I love the beat. but while you're dancing, the lyrics are becoming embedded into your biology.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And so one of the things that I think you're suggesting as a remedy would be to do these freedom schools, or what I call alternative schools, in the afternoons and on the weekends, and maybe
right.
teaching the history through music and through drama.
Right.
So that would have a
good
way of infecting
yes.
children in a more positive way.
And adults as well. We've done this before. You know, there's something that the genre of so-called protest music.
Right.
But I would want to think of it as liberation music.
Absolutely.
To liberate our minds.
Absolutely.
And that has to be done
Hello? Have we lost Professor Adams again? We may have lost him again. I don't know. But in case he does get back, we will try to reconnect. But in case he doesn't, I think the points that he made are very salient in terms of us looking as community, as families, as friends, as developing some mechanism where we are training our children outside of the regular public school or even private school system, so that we can begin to help teach them, one, critical thinking, teach them media literacy, and helping them to empower themselves as we empower ourselves to be about liberation and not about subjugation. We really are in a serious war, as he indicated, and that war is going to be fought at many levels, mind, body, and spirit. And mostly right now is mental and spiritual, although we are seeing people die.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, I was just trying to fill in for you until you got back on. We have about 2 minutes before we have to end, and I was just, let me finish by saying that you were alluding to the fact that we need to develop these alternative educational resources so that we can begin to train our next generation as well as empower this generation about thinking liberation instead of subjugation. You may go on.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. And that's one of the things that the protesters are missing. You know, it's one thing to protest against injustice in all its various forms and police brutality. But what are you going to do after that? What's next? And what's next is folks have to liberate their minds, because we have to decolonize everything. It's not enough to take down Confederate statues and things like that. Those are simple things. Then we have to also remember, young people have to remember, is that there's a lot at stake in this. You know, corporations are looking at the future of their brand, and so they will go through an apology program to appease people because they want to keep them as customers. And so we have to watch what we consume at the same time. That has to be a message, but I'm willing to bet that message of critical thinking, of media literacy, cultural literacy will not be something that will be talked about at this upcoming march on Washington.
Well,
and so we have to do it ourselves.
As we get to the end of the hour, as was once said, the revolution will not be televised. And so what I'd like to do, Professor Adams, is bring you back sometime in August to finish this discussion, because we did have a couple of interruptions, and I think it's very critical and it's important for our listening audience to hear. So we have to end right now, unfortunately, but I want to wish everybody a great week, a safe and healthy week, and we'll be back next week with the Bamboozlement Index and Attorney Jack Child. Thank you and have a great week. Goodbye.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.